Hi everyone, welcome to Excel Clinic. We will be accruing for unutilized leave today. With the travel restriction easing, if you have been accruing for full entitlements in the past 2 years, it is time to revisit your computation. Computing leave accrual can be very tedious if you have many employees. Each of them would have a different leave utilization pattern, but no worry, follow me, no OT. Before we build the template, let's revisit what is leave accrual. The applicable accounting standard is IAS 19, Employee Benefits. IAS 19 classifies paid annual leave as short-term employee benefits, and long-term paid leave as other long-term employee benefits because it is not settled wholly within 12 months from the end of the current annual period. Long service leave are not common in Singapore, but it is in Australia and maybe some other countries. The accounting treatments for two is about the same. But the long-term service leave accrual would involve a higher level of uncertainty and require discounting. What kind of leave needs to be accrued? Before that, we need to understand why an accrual is needed. IAS 19 takes the same concept as the other accruals, what I call the balance sheet approach. We need to accrue for something we receive but remain unsettled as at the period end. Consider this example. I'm entitled to 12 days of annual leave. I worked for a year, but only took 10 days leave. The remaining 2 days are unsettled at current year end and can be carried forward to next year. This is the unsettled cost as at year end. There is one very common misconception about leave accrual. If the leaves cannot be encashed, meaning non-vesting, then there is no need for accrual. As the name itself suggests, paid leaves are paid. Whether or not there is an encashment option, it doesn't matter. But I can see where the confusion is coming from. I will explain this from another angle, and hopefully it helps you to understand why encashment or not is not relevant. Let's consider this example. Jack is paid $260,000 a year. There are 260 working days each year. Of the 260 days, Jack only needs to work 248 days and he is entitled to 12 days of paid leave. Unutilized leave in year 1 can be carried forward to year 2. Due to the COVID travel restrictions in year 1, Jack did not take any leave. Following the easing of the restrictions in year 2, he went on a vacation. He took 24 days of leave, 12 from the current year entitlement and 12 from year 1 entitlement. What IAS 19 says is that at the end of year 1, the entity has an obligation to pay for the 12 days of leave carried forward and taken in year 2. Explaining this from another angle, what I call the profit and loss approach, the entity received 12 days of service more in year 1. And 12 days of service less in year 2. So naturally, we should allocate higher costs to year 1. In this case, 12,000 additional costs in year 1 and 12,000 less in year 2. This is an explanation that helped me understand. However, it is not the most accurate interpretation of the standard. In sum, as long as the leaves are accumulating, that is, can be carried forward to the next financial period, it needs to be accrued. This is regardless of whether it is vesting. What if the leave year of the company is not aligned with the financial year? This is common in Singapore. Most entities have their leave year aligned to calendar year, running from January to December. However, some of them have financial years that do not end in December. Given that the leave year cut across the financial years, even if the unutilized leave cannot be carried forward to the next leave year, it will still be accumulating for the purpose of accounting. This is because the leave balance does not reset at the current financial year end and will be carried forward to the next financial year. One last thing before we go to Excel. The formula. The formula depends very much on company policy and regulation. A typical convention I've seen is this. Accrual balance is the leave balance in days multiplied by salary per day. You also need to consider the probability of employees leaving the company before utilizing the leaves. This is applicable if the leave are non-vesting. If it is vesting, then even if the employees do not utilize the leave, it will be encashed. So the probability will be 1. As an employee, I will always want to utilize all my leave benefits before I leave the company. So I would think that in most circumstances, it will be reasonable to assume that all accumulating leaves will be fully utilized or encashed. Okay, Excel time. We have a list of employees, their salaries, their leave entitlements, and the number of days used, and the date of joining. We have an employee, Bruno, join us during the year. Add two rows above, to indicate the start of the leave year and the end of the current period. Assuming the convention to compute earned leave in this case is based on the number of completed months, we need a column to determine the first day on which the employee starts rendering service to the company in the current leave period. For all other employees, it will be the first day of the leave year, 1st January 2022. But for Bruno, it will start later on his date of joining. Stop. No, this is not how we build a reusable Excel template. Let's use a function to determine the later of the leave year start and date of joining. Equal max. Start of the leave year, make the reference absolute, and then the date of joining. To compute the number of completed months, we need to use DateDiff. I talked about DateDiff in my previous video. Do you still remember how to use DateDiff? Equals DateDiff. The first argument is the start date, which is column F. The second argument is the end date, which is the end of the current period. The third argument is the character M, wrapped in double quotation marks. To compute the earned leave, the formula is pretty straightforward. Leave balance is column H less column D. It is common that companies allow employee to take leaves before they actually earn them. In other words, the full year entitlements are credited to the leave system on the first day of the leave year. However, if the employees leave during the year, then they have to compensate for the unearned leaves taken. We can see that Jennifer leaves balance is -7.5. She took more than she earned as at 30th April. The excess should be recognized as a prepayment instead. Now, we need to translate unutilized leave in days to an amount. Again, it depends on policy and regulation. A common convention of computing daily pay is taking 12 months worth of pay divided by 260 days, being 5 days a week for 52 weeks in a year. The total accrual will be the total of the positive numbers. The total prepayment will be the total of the negative numbers. To compute the sum, our favorite function, SUMIFS. Here you go. If you like a copy of this demo file, subscribe to my YouTube channel and email or PM me. Like and share this video if you learned something that allows you to work more efficiently. Do subscribe to our channel so that you will not miss the next episode. See ya next week.